Thank you, Thierry, and good morning, everyone. So, in my presentation, I will introduce the teleoperation scenario, which indeed has been already presented by Mattia in his presentation, but I will focus on an aspect which has not yet been addressed during the previous presentation. The work done in this scenario and the achievements have been reached within the work package 6 of Tactivity. Yes, first of all, okay. This is me. I'm Maurizio Verde. I'm professor of electronics at the University of Genova. Our research lab is named COSMIC, Connected Object Sensing Materials and Integrated Circuits. Genova, you can see Genova for those who do not know where it is located. It is located in Italy on the seashore north of Italy, and a picture, a nice picture of Genova downtown. But let me move directly to the topic of the presentation. So I use this this picture taken from a paper just to introduce the teleoperation scenario, even if I think it is clear to all of you, but let me go on. So you can see here on one side, on the left, the operator, which controls with the various, in various ways, through, for instance, through leap motion detection, or other tools, a robot which is represented on the left, on the right side. The robot is a robotic arm with a manipulator, and onto the robot are mounted some sensors, a camera, and force and torque sensor. So there is a loop between these two systems, in the sense that on one side, control commands are sent, communicated by the operator to the robot in order to manage the and to control the operation which is being implemented. On the other side, a set of information concerning the operation and the environment is relayed back to the operator. In this case, the information relayed back is visual information measured by the camera, and the information measured by the torque force sensors. Usually, the operator and the robot are put at a distance, so the loop is, and the information is conveyed forth and back using a communication channel, which is, in case of long distance, internet. So, in order to be effective, the loop and the operation performed by the robot, the information measured at the robot site must be very rich in order to make the operator able to apply most convenient operations and control at best the robot operation itself. So, in order to do that, the again, the main requirement, there are main requirements. One is that the measured information on the robot side must be rich and very informative. and must be relayed to the operator in a seamless, hopefully seamless, and intuitive way. And moreover, all the loop must be operated in real time. So the latency introduced by the communication network and introduced by all the devices involved must be as low as possible in order for the in order to be effective the control of the robot itself. So this is the reference scenario for us, and we added a very important feature aspect in this scenario, which is the electronic scheme, in the sense that we aimed at the beginning of tactility to develop high sensitive and high spatial distribution tactile sensors to be mounted onto the manipulator, remote manipulator, in order to measure and measure fine interaction of the anthropomorphic and with the environment, with the objects, to measure relevant information about the contact, relevant and distributed information about the contact, and we want to convey such information to the user in a somatotopic way. For instance, in this case, you see that the operator wears some vibro-tactile bracelets, and Mattia and Straini already introduced explained to you all the drawbacks of this kind of feedback. So in place of the vibro-tactile actuators, our aim is to use electro-tactile, highly distributed, high bandwidth electro-tactile feedback, using exploiting the achievements on this side of tactility, of the other work packages of tactility. Of course, latency must be taken under control, and it is one of the main parameters to be checked and assessed during the development. So, this is the scenario. Mattia already introduced to you this the scenario, the reference scenario, teleoperation scenario of tactility. So we developed high density sensitive electronic scheme to be mounted on a robotic and effector, and developed also the interface electronics and all what concerns the extraction of information and the communication of the information to the local operator, which receives the feedback using pads through electro-tactile stimulation, and the pads are distributed all over the end in a way similar to the distribution of the sensors onto the robotic end effector or anthropomorphic end, which is used onto the remote slave. So this is the overall scenario. I now will focus onto the tactile sensing. In our lab, we have been working on tactile sensing since more than 10 years, and we have applied and further developed our approach into tactility. And I will show you, and my presentation is a kind of a preview of what the people attending in person in Technalia, the workshop, could experience during the demo during the afternoon. So, first of all, a comment. There have been in the literature over the last 30 years, many different approaches, systems, technologies for implementing tactile sensing have been presented. The approaches presented very different transducing materials, very different architecture, and so on. But to our knowledge, none of them till now have been implemented with high density sensing onto robotic manipulators and put into a loop as the one that I involved by the teleoperation scenario. So, first of all, this is to our knowledge a very innovative achievement. So, we need some elements, some blocks in order to implement the tactile sensing system. We need to choose a sensing material acting as transducer, in order to be able to translate the mechanical interaction force, pressure into analog electrical signals. Then we need an interface electronics in order to acquire signals and extract from the signals the proper information to be relayed back with a proper electrotactile stimulation approach to the operator, to the local operator. So let us focus first on to the requirements. The requirements in particular for the manipulation are quite challenging. So we need a detectable force range of three orders of magnitude, a bandwidth which is up to 1 kHz, high spatial resolutions because we are thinking on fingertips, and the spatial resolution should be close to the one of the human hand in order to implement a biologically plausible approach. Then the sensors must be flexible in order to conform to the surface of the robotic manipulator, to some extent stretchable, robust, low cost in particular, and of course the embedded electronic system must be of small size, miniaturized, must work in real time, and of course must be also low power. So this is the timeline of the development that we experienced in our research lab. First of all, we choose as transducer material a piezoelectric polymer. Piezoelectric materials have the feature that when you apply a force or a pressure onto a piezoelectric film, then the piezoelectric film develops on its two main surfaces an electrical signal, mainly a charge. The amount of charge is proportional to the magnitude of the mechanical contact. Moreover, we choose a polymer which, for the reason that a polymer can be screen printed onto a plastic support like PET. And so it is also quite easily can be manufactured at low cost and also with high density. So I move straight to the structure of the tactile sensor. The structure is this one. You can see on this side the single sensor is a kind of capacitor. The insulating material of the capacitor is replaced by the piezoelectric polymer. Then two conductive plates are deposited on top and bottom. All this stuff is printed on a plastic substrate like PET. And at the end, a thin cover layer, you can see some microns of thickness, is deposited on top just for protecting the sensor itself. So the structure is represented in this figure, and this structure can be easily. Quite easily, let's say, screen printed on TPU. So, when a pressure is applied onto the capacitor, the proportional charge is collected onto the conductive electrodes and further managed by the interface electronics for the signal acquisition. Yes, concerning the interface electronics, at the beginning of our activity on this topic, we started with the commercial data acquisition boards, and later on we moved forward with the aim of integrating all the interface electronic block into miniaturized PCBs in order to be easily embedded onto the target system. You can see the size of one of our recent PC prototypes on the right side. Okay, so we brought this approach into tactility, and we implemented what we have called a skin patch. A skin patch is made of a tactile sensing array whose structure and geometry was shown in the previous slide. Then we have to take that, put other two layers of conducting material on top and bottom. And the reason of the further two layers are is that we need to shield with respect to the environmental noise and disturbances the sensors which are now embedded with within these two metallic shields which are further connected to ground. You can see here the skin patch. The skin patch is connected to the embedded electronics, which is inside this box. And then the interface electronics is connected through USB to a PC. Then you can see on the right side the output of different tactile interaction with the, no, sorry. Sorry, I come back to the previous slide. Yes, the tactile interaction with the output waveforms of the signals. Oh, sorry, again, I have to come back to step. Okay. No, I don't know why now. Okay, sorry for this. I change also my pointer. Yes, okay. So on top, a gentle sliding of the digit on the sensors. The output of the sensors are visualized onto the screen. You see they are voltage analog signals. And no, I couldn't visualize the bottom video. Okay, in any case, I skip to the next slide. So then, based on this approach, we developed, implemented a set of skin patches. You can see them on the left side. The skin patches are meant to cover most of the end of the robotic end effector. We used as a robotic end effector and Michelangelo prosthetic end. You can see that the distribution of the sensors onto the Michelangelo end. Each red dot is a sensor. At the end, we achieved 64 sensors. We tried to emulate the distribution of mechanoreceptors of the human hand, of course, with a number of sensors, which is smaller with respect to the biological counterpart. In any case, we developed also the interface electronics, a miniaturized interface electronics, which is able to manage up to 64 channels, 64 sensors as the overall number of sensors that we have deployed at a full sampling rate for each sensor, which is which we are able to sample to operate at 2 kilo sample per second per for each of the channels, and then the interface electronics, which is very very small, is connected either to USB or to Bluetooth, or to the PC, the host PC, or directly to the electrotactile stimulator. We implemented the first system one. In this case, we instrumented, we sensorized only the index finger of the Michelangelo hand. You can see it onto this is a mock-up of the Michelangelo hand, so we can apply only passive touches. And in this case, the feedback was not somatotopic. We put the pads for the electrotactile stimulation on the forearm of the subjects. In any case, we could validate the behavior and the operation of the wall system, and we measure the latency of 32 milliseconds. Then we moved to a more complex system, which is the current one, and the one that will be demonstrated in the afternoon. We sensorized the fingertips and the palm of the Michelangelo hand. Here on the left, the distribution of the pad of the sensors is this one. We have 64 sensors. On the right side, we put onto the end of the subject a number of pads for the electrotactile stimulation. In this case, the number of pads is 32, but of course it can be extended up to 64. And we used this bandage in order to keep the contact between the pads and the skin of the operator. The information which is relayed back to the operator is binary. So we define the threshold for the sensor waveform. And if the signal has a magnitude bigger than the threshold, then it means that the contact happened onto the sensor. So we activate, as a consequence, the pad which corresponds to the sensor, to the active sensor. So this is the system, the demonstration of the system. You can see the mock-up, and on the back, on the left, the activated sensors. On the right, now in the next, let's wait. You see here on the right, the pads that have been activated. Of course, we have on one side 64 sensors, on the other side 32 pads. So we implemented a kind of special fusion. You can see from the video that the response is in real time. So the activation of the dots in the graphical user interface is in real time with respect to the mechanical contact. This is the same setup, but with a different contact. So this is a dynamic contact, and you see that the system, the output, can follow in real time the touch, the dynamic touch, which has been implemented, applied onto the mock-up of the Michelangelo hand. We show now in the next slide the wall system, where we have added, just for demonstration, a picoscope in order to show also the waveforms on two channels, because of the limitations of the picoscope, that will be applied to the end of the operator. Then this is the Michelangelo hand with the sensors, mock-up, the tactility alpha stimulator, but we will move to the beta version. This is the picoscope, and you can see the two screens. On the right screen, we will show the waveforms applied to the skin of the human operator as the electrotactile feedback, and this is shown here in this next video. You see on this screen the waveforms on two channels, on two pads, on two activated pads, and these are the waveforms for on two channels, of course, on two pads, which could be applied to the human hand of the operator if when the operator is connected. We are the pad. So the same here in case of dynamic patterns. In this case, a screw driver is rolled over the skin. You can see that the skin is able to measure also light touches. All this will be demonstrated live this afternoon for people present. Next step is on one side, on the left side, the Michelangelo hand, which has been fully sensorized. On the right side, you see here the arrays of pads, which have been implemented by the group of Mattia Stabach in Technalia, and the geometry of these pads is closely emulates the geometry of the sensors which have been put onto the Michelangelo hand. You see below the bandage and the way that we put the pads for the electrotactile stimulation onto the hand of the subject. And here you can see the distribution of the pads with the anode and cathode. We made the experiments. We validated this system, and the system that we have validated is shown in this video. So the Michelangelo hand with the sensors, then electrotactile, then the graphical user interface on the PC, the stimulator, still in the alpha version, and here the bandage and the pads mounted onto the arm of the subject. With this setup, we made a set of experiments onto some subjects by applying both static touches, touching single sensors, and also dynamic ones, dynamic patterns. So sliding a finger onto the onto the robotic hand, the fingers of the robotic hand. Of course, the subject could not see what was happening onto the robotic hand. At the end, the results have been very, very nice. You can see that we achieved a success rate of more than 90% in case of distributed analog configuration, which is the most effective analog configuration, while a average or success rate, average success rate of almost 90% for static pattern, static contacts. These results are published on a paper which will appear in July onto the proceedings of Philosophical Transactions of the Royal Society in the UK. So to summarize, what we have achieved till now is this. System 1 and System 2 has been validated, extensively validated. In these two systems, we used a mock-up, and you will see in the demo a mock-up of the Michelangelo hand. So we could, we can apply only static static contacts. Sorry, passive contacts, static or dynamic, but passive. So the next step will be to move to the real Michelangelo hand, and this step is very close. In fact, we developed a removable solution which can be easily mounted and unmounted onto the Michelangelo hand. Into this picture, the hand which is shown is the real Michelangelo hand with the removable solution. So the next steps, which will be implemented in May, June, July, will be to test this system, with the real Michelangelo hand, taking into account also of the latency introduced by the internet communication. Then we plan to make a step forward within the end of tactility, which means to use the tactility glove instead of the, which has been introduced to you in the previous presentation, in place of the bandage, which is shown in the upper picture of the presentation. This is the timeline. I won't comment into detail this slide, but this shows the timelines of the achievements and the implementations and the results that we achieved during tactility. And yes, this is our final goal, and we plan to achieve it, I repeat this, within tactility. I want to thank all the people who collaborated and are collaborating to this development, the guys of our lab, Yahya Abbas, Mustafa Saleh, Lucia Seminara, Christian Giannoglio, Professor Strainia, Dosen, and the group in Aalborg, and the staff of SmartEx, Rita Paradiso and Maria Pacelli, we had, and of course, all the other partners involved in tactility. We had a very, very exciting and very effective collaboration with all of them. I thank you all for your attention, and I'm open to your questions.
Okay, thank you, Maurizio, for your presentation. We can take one short question before